Aksum at the twilight. Even after the momentous events of Aksum's conquest of South Arabia, when the Persians took over South Arabia and Islam spread in the region, pushing the Christian empire further west into the mountains, Ethiopia's importance in the region continued unabated. A well-known essay titled Hudub al-Alam, 1980, authored by a Persian writer in AD 983, for example, states, "This country, Ethiopia, has a very mild climate. They obey their own king. Merchants from Oman, Hejaz, and Bahrain often go to that country for trade purposes." 372. A historian at the time named Al-Yaqubi described Aksum during the last decade of the first millennium as follows. "Aksum is a vast and powerful country. They have big cities, and their seacoast is called Dahlak. The largest of their kingdoms is the kingdom of the Nahashi, who is a Christian. Their capital is called Kafar, possibly Ankobar." Khalidi, 1975-29. Yet in another work, El-Mas'udi provides interesting information about the reach of the Aksumite Empire on the Red Sea coast. In his geographical text, Muruj al-Dahab, Metals of Gold, he comments, "The principal city of the Habasha people is called Kubar, Ankobar, which is a large township, and the residence of the Nahashi king, whose empire extends to the coast opposite the Yemen, and possesses such towns as Zaila, Dahlak, and Nasi." Al-Mas'udi, 1841, page 10. After the Persians replaced the Aksumites in Arabia, one notable development was documented in Islamic history, Islamic records in Hadith, which is a tradition based on reports of the sayings and physical activities of the Prophet Muhammad and his companions, point out that Arma, Emperor of Aksum, provided refuge to the first generation of Muhammad's followers when they faced severe persecution in Mecca in AD 615. And among the more than 100 refugees who participated in what is known in the Muslim tradition as the first Hijra, were Muhammad's son-in-law and successor Uthman ibn Affan, the Prophet's daughter Ruqayya, his cousin Ja'far bin Ali Talib, and two of the Prophet's wives, Habiba and Salma. Notwithstanding the Prophet's directive not to attack Ethiopia, however, several jihads were conducted against the country, and the lowlands areas to the north and east of the empire were Islamized. This led to the almost total isolation of the Christian empire for over 1,000 years. The original home of this dynasty was Agao, located in Lasta district, a Cushitic society that preceded the Semites of northern and central Ethiopia. They frustrated the attempt of the Fatimid caliphs of Egypt, who tried to put Ethiopia under their own sphere of influence. They expanded the Christian empire beyond the Muslim Sultanate of Shoah and exerted direct sovereign control over Dahlak Islands in present-day Eritrea. The most important legacy of the Sagwes, who ruled Ethiopia for a century and a half, was their imprint in the construction of magnificent churches around their capital at Adifa, later named for King Lalbela. Furthermore, the influence of the Sagwes in the Near East was so prominent that in 1178, Salah al-Din, the Sultan of Egypt and Syria, granted Ethiopia the use of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and the chapel of the Invention of the Cross, as well as a station in the Grotto of the Nativity in Bethlehem. Prester John, the man known in Ethiopia as Yimrahana Christos, was referred to in Europe during the time of the Crusades as Prest or John. Latin, prete anai. Yim Rahanana, Christos was the first of the four emperor saints of the Zagwe dynasty, and he ruled Ethiopia for 40 years. The emperor was devoted to the church, and besides his imperial duties, he used to serve as a priest. He was the only Ethiopian emperor who was priest king. His first appearance in historical documents was in the Chronicle of Ato, Phrasing, who had heard word of a powerful Christian sovereign reigning in the east in 1145 from a Syrian bishop who had arrived at the papal court in Viterbo. During the Fifth Crusade, which took place at the beginning of the 13th century, information about Ethiopia trickled to Europe. The European reports suggested that Prester John was a devoted priest as well as a great monarch. European writers soon started to depict Prester John as a great monarch who resided in a grand palace, carried an emerald scepter, was attended by hundreds of princes, and had an archbishop as a butler and a king as a chief cook. Others gave their imaginations free rein. Prester John, they wrote, had a magic mirror through which he could glance at every corner of his vast empire. His robes, washed only in fire, were woven by salamanders. Ludovico Ariosto, the famous early Renaissance poet, was inspired by these fantasies to describe the land of Pretahani, Prester John, as a place where one could find golden chained drawbridges with solid crystal columns, musk, balsam, and umber in every corner, and a palace whose walls and ceilings were studded with pearls and whose rooms differed from each other in that the floors of some were made of rubies, whereas others were covered with topazes and sapphires. The restoration of the Solomonian dynasty. There was a great deal of achievement during the reign of the Cushitic Zawi dynasty, but the Semites, who believed that the Agao people had usurped the throne, were working hard to overthrow them. The Semites ultimately succeeded in their aims and installed Yekuno Amlak, 1270-1300, who claimed descent from King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba in place of Neakuto Le'eab. Depicted in the Old Testament Kings chapter 10 verse 1 to 13, the connection between Yekuno Amlak's dynasty and Solomon and Sheba also was elaborately narrated in the Kebra Negesht, which appeared in tandem. Menelik, it was also claimed in the Kebra Negesht, brought to Ethiopia the Ark of the Covenant, which was given to Moses by God. But there were claims and counterclaims to the throne that led to a drastic solution. All claimants of the throne had to be imprisoned on an escarpment of Gishon, with literally no possibility escape except for one entrance that was heavily guarded. The rise of the Solomonian dynasty in the 13th century signaled the ascendancy of the Amhara ruling classes, who controlled power until the time of Emperor Haile Selassie I and the Derg's overthrown by the Tigray People's Liberation Front in 1991. The era of the princess. When Ioas, an Oromo-speaking emperor, took over power and ruled from 1755 to 1769, Ras Mikael Seyul of Tigray was summoned by traditionalists in Amhara to aid in resisting the Oromo's leadership of the empire. Mikael made his move at a time when two Dowager queens were fighting to control state machinery in the name of their imperial sons, both with the support of different Oromo warlords. After removing the Oromo kingmakers, Mikael dictated policy decisions in Ethiopia for a period of 25 years while acting as a regent of a series of weak emperors. Initially, Emperor Ioas attempted to get Mikael assassinated, but Mikael survived, purged the emperor, and handpicked the next three emperors, Johannes II, Tekle Haymanot II and Tekle Georgis I. During the Zamana Masafint era of the princes, the power of the emperors had waned, and the regional kings of Shoah, Gondar, and Gojam were in full control of political power in their territories. After 25 years of being a power broker in Gondar, Mikhail Sehul's influence ultimately came to an end when the Oromos regrouped and defeated him. During the heyday of the Zamana Masafint, the princes running their autonomous regions were subject to raids from other warlords who coveted an additional realm. Markanish bint Karbenal was a 13th century celebrated Christian queen who ruled her dominion in the area of Harar. According to the Fat Madinat Harar, an unpublished chronicle of Harar from the 13th century, Markanish was a sovereign of the Christians who fought against Abadir Omar al-Rida, the Harari spiritual and secular leader, and his disciples. The Fatih indicates that she took the throne from her brother Jurnial in 1253, following his conversion to the Islamic religion. When he challenged her rule, Markanish engaged him in battle, where he died in 1257. Unfortunately, Markanish herself was martyred by the forces of Abadir in 1290. In an Oromo village near Argoba, Zareyaikob, Emperor Zareyaikob, the name means offspring of Jacob, ruled Ethiopia for 34 years, 1434-1468. His reign was one of the most eventful during the Middle Ages. He conducted an unsuccessful military campaign to convert the Falasha Beit Israel community in Gondar province, which practiced a non-Talmudic form of Judaism, to Christianity. His major passion was, however, to achieve national unity and to break Muslim encirclement. He was a reformer of the church as well as the social and religious life in his domain. He had to wage a series of wars against Muslims, potentate of the periphery, and three of his brothers died in that struggle. The emperor dealt Ifat, one of the most powerful Muslim kingdoms on the periphery, such a crushing military blow that there the latter's hegemony passed to the sultans of Adal in Harar province. Zareyaikob believed in uprightness, both religiously and in social life. In this, he did not distinguish between the nearest of kin and others. If he felt that a law had not been followed, he took severe action to punish those accused of the act. Zareyaikob had his wife flogged to death when she attempted a palace coup in favor of her son. He also executed three of his daughters for worshipping idols. As a learned Deptera prince, Zareyaikob followed theological trends at home and abroad. He dispatched delegates to the Council of Florence 1431-1444. He also created links with the Western churches, including Rome. He wrote religious tracts extensively. Among the major ones he left behind when he died were the Creed of the Ethiopian Church and five other theological treatises. Zareyaikob encouraged the development of literature at every level. He reformed the administration of the church and reformulated the church calendar. During that time, many peasants stopped farming the land. Unpaid soldiers and shiftas, outlaws, made their normal life very difficult. There was a continuous civil war and a series of bloody conflicts, such as many as six rival emperors claimed the Solomonian throne in 1800. The last kingpin of the Zamanat Masafint was in fact an Oromo warlord named Ras Ali, who was defeated by Emperor Teodros, an Amhara emperor who ended the era of state anarchy in Ethiopia. Though he united his realm under a centralized state machinery, the new emperor faced a series of rebellions, one of which was directed by the ambitious young Menelik, who escaped from the imperial prison at Magdala and raised his own army in his father's kingdom of Shoa, where he had crowned himself king. The reign of Emperor Tewodros, 1855-1868. Despite the rebellions from every province and from the church, which opposed his interference in their control of large estate holdings, Tewodros succeeded in setting up a modern-style system. He established a salaried military and administrative, judicial, and civil service contingents to protect the country against foreign invasion and to run state affairs smoothly. Zadingle was the emperor of Ethiopia 1603-1604, who converted from Orthodox Tewahedo to Catholicism. Under the influence of the Jesuits, Zadingle was eager to announce his conversion, even against the urgings of his Jesuit friend Pedro Pius. Opposing the Ethiopian Orthodox tradition, he published a proclamation ordering that it was henceforth illegal to keep the Jewish Sabbath as a holiday. He instructed that only Sunday be celebrated in keeping with Roman Catholicism. Zadingle wrote in a letter dated June 26, 1604, to Pope Clement VIII of the Vatican that as Emperor of Ethiopia, he acknowledged the Pope's ecclesiastical supremacy. This brought about the Emperor's excommunication, Awon. He was confronted in battle by Orthodox Christian zealots led by Ras Atnateos of Amhara, who, supported by the Ethiopian clergy, had already passed a death sentence on him. To make matters worse for him, his army, which was almost wholly Orthodox, deserted. when defeat seemed inevitable, he marched south and took refuge in Anaria, near present-day Jimma in the Kaffa region. In his absence, the dissidents stormed the treasure house of Gishen and impounded the entire imperial wardrobe with 12 cases of gold chains and ornaments. Then, in hot pursuit, they crossed the Abai and followed Zadingle to Anaria. The emperor, who was guarded by a Portuguese contingent and few thousand loyal troops, decided to engage the rebels, camping on the plain of Barca. On the evening of October 14, 1604, he faced enemies head-on. 200 Portuguese carrying muskets were sure that Zadingle would win, but that was not to be. As the battle progressed, his army was decimated, the emperor was unhorsed, encircled, and speared. The coup de grace was delivered by Rasselas, governor of Dambia. With a lance hurled from a distance, he was then beheaded. The body of the emperor was exhumed from the field of battle a few days later and moved to the monastery of Dak Estefa on Lake Tana. The winners then restored the deposed Emperor Yaikob in his place after the latter swore to be loyal to the country's Miaphysite fate. Tewodros's fall came when, slighted and angered by the British government's failure to promptly answer his request for a bilateral allegiance against the Ottomans and a supply of European technicians, Tewodros imprisoned the British consul in his realm, as well as the special envoy of Queen Victoria and several European missionaries. As a result, the British dispatched to Ethiopia a military expedition under the command of General Napier. Prior to attempting the march through the difficult terrain of Ethiopia, Napier made clear to the country's feudal lords, who were rivals to Tewodros, that the British government's intention was solely to secure its nationals and other foreigners who were illegally imprisoned. The British consequently succeeded in negotiating the difficult mountainous terrain of Ethiopia and a joining battle with the emperor at Makdala. Tewodros's army, clearly no match for Napier's well-armed military force, was speedily defeated, and the Ethiopian emperor, in order to avoid the indignity of capture by his enemies, committed suicide with a pistol previously given to him by Queen Victoria. Hundreds of illuminated manuscripts that are now deposited at the British Library and the Royal Library in Windsor Castle, among other locations, are remnants of this war booty. An engraving from the Illustrated London News showing Emperor Tewodros Theodore II of Ethiopia committing suicide on April 13, 1868, as British troops arrived to free more than 40 European prisoners, including the British consul Charles Duncan Cameron and his retinue, at the mountain fortress of Magdala in central Ethiopia. The regent of Emperor Johannes VI, an intense power struggle ensued following Tewodros' death. A Zagwe descendant named Tekla Giorgis crowned himself briefly, but was soon overthrown by Dejismach Kasa Mircea of Tigray, who had helped Napier in the anti-Tewodros campaign and in return received plenty of firearms, including artillery pieces with which he subdued his rivals. Kasa was crowned emperor in 1872 under the throne name of Johannes VI. Emperor Johannes had to defend Ethiopian territorial integrity against a series of foreign invading forces. The Egyptians attempted to conquer Ethiopia and thus secure the headwaters of the Blue Nile, which is a primary source of their livelihood. Was also frustrated when twice in 1875 and 1876 the armies of Khedavi Ismail faced crushing defeats. With the tacit approval of the British, the Italian colonists usurped the formerly Turkish and Egyptian occupied Ethiopian seaport of Massawa in 1885. They then embarked on an aggressive expansion campaign further into the highlands, only to be decisively defeated by Emperor Johannes at the Battle of Togali in 1887. That same year, the messianic Islamist of Sudan, known as the Mahdist, encroached on Ethiopian territory. After defeating King Tekle Haimanut, the regional king of Goham and Begemder, the Mahdist forces devastated the old Ethiopian capital of Gondar. In retaliation, Johannes moved in full force against the Sudan. Before his death, Johannes commanded his able general Ras Alula to crown the emperor's son Ras Mengesha. The Zemene Mesafint, or Era of the Princes, 1706-1855. This was a time in Ethiopian history when autonomous regions under independent warlords proliferated outside the political control of the central imperial government. Zemena Masafint started with the assassination of Iyasu the Great, which led to a gradual decline of the Solomonian dynasty. What followed was a power struggle between his mother, Empress Mentewab, and his widow, Wubit. Rivalries also intensified among Oromo, Amharas, and Tigray warlords. Iyasu's son Iyoas, who was brought up by his Oromo cousins, took the throne as a child and made Afan Oromo the court language of Gondar. This enraged the Gondar Amharas. The young emperor also openly favored his Oromo cousins. For example, on the death of the ruling Ras, Duke of Amhara, Iyoas appointed his uncle Lubo as governor. As the conflict between the Oromos and the Amharas in Gondar intensified, Ras Mikael Sehul of Tigray, who had accumulated firearms through the port of Massawa, found an opportunity to intercede. He immediately took power and purged the Oromo warlords, basing his power on an Amhara Tigray coalition. When the young emperor raised his Oromo uncle Fasil to power, Mikael Sehul deposed and then assassinated Yoas. From the Wahini Khail, where all imperial contenders were incarcerated, Mikael brought out and crowned Johannes II, a prince who was very old and not interested in political power. When Mikael's plan to have Johannes marry his daughter was rejected, Mikael had Johannes assassinated. Mikael Sehul was in the end defeated by Oromo warlords. He was allowed to retreat to Tigray, thereby leaving the control of the imperial throne to the Oromos one more time. The Oromos continued to be kingmakers until Kassa of Gondar from the Amhara region of Uara, who had no claim to the Solomonian dynasty, fought his way up and crowned himself Emperor Tewodros II in 1855. Emperor Menelik and Ethiopia's historic victory at the Battle of Adwa. Despite Johannes' strong wish to pass on the crown to his son, the emperor's Amhara rival Menelik of Shoah, who had for a long time aspired to climb the Solomonian throne, came forcefully. In fact, Menelik had not recognized Johannes as emperor until 1878-1879, when the Shoan Negus faced a military defeat in a struggle between the two monarchs. Throughout the next decade, Menelik engineered Ethiopia's return into the southern and western regions that had been abandoned in the 17th century when the kingdoms of Ifat, Dawaro, Fatagar, and Damot were swept away by the swift tide of Oromo warrior age, the groups known as Lubas. By waging numerous wars with the new weapons he had acquired from Europe, Menelik succeeded in incorporating within his domain all major Oromo confederacies and sovereign territories, including those of Arsi, Harar, Jima, Limu, and Wayaga, and several other kingdoms and states of southern Ethiopia, such as Kaffa, Walaeta, Sidama, and Janjara. Janjaro. In their conquest of the south, Menelik and his followers were inspired by the idea that they were regaining lands that had once been part of the Christian Empire. For them, it was a holy crusade to restore Ethiopia to its historic grandeur. Menelik, who feared that Johannes' son Mengesha, supported by the famous imperial army general Ras Alula, might try to follow his father to the throne, made a pact with the Italians in 1888. The Italians in turn provided Menelik with plenty of firearms. In the meantime, Menelik attempted to unify the empire and introduced modernization. Through diplomatic negotiations with France, he succeeded in having a railway built, thus connecting his capital city of Addis Ababa to the Red Sea coast of Djibouti. He opened the first Western-style school as well as the first modern hospital. He introduced the conveniences of the telegraph and electric power into his empire. He established the printing press and launched a relatively liberal news magazine, Aimero, where freedom of the press was for the first time exercised by his newly educated elite. The Shoan monarch's agreement with the Italians resulted in an untractable squabble when the Italians interpreted Article 17 of the Treaty of Ucciale, concluded in 1889 by the Italians and Menelik, as giving Italy a protectorate status over Ethiopia. Though it was utterly inconceivable that Menelik would have agreed to his historic country becoming a protectorate of Italy or any other power. The new emperor soon learned that the Italian interpretation concocted by the Italian envoy Count Antonelli was slowly gaining ground in Europe. The Italian colonists who had by 1890 established themselves along the Red Sea coast in an area that they had named the colony of Eritrea, soon risked a major confrontation with Menelik's army, only to be soundly defeated by a hastily mobilized Ethiopian peasant army in one of the greatest battles in the history of the world, the Battle of Adwa of March 1, 1896. Historically speaking, Adwa was the most major military operation between the Africans and the Europeans since the time of Hannibal in 200 BC. For Ethiopia, it was the most triumphal. For Italy, it was the most disastrous. The Italian colonist invaders were defeated totally. All their artillery pieces were captured. One out of four of their generals was taken prisoner. Two of the remaining generals, as well as half of their staff officers, were killed. Following the victory, Italy and the European powers categorically recognized Ethiopian sovereignty, and Menelik returned back to Addis Ababa to carry out the consolidation of his empire and the modernization drive he had started. His age advancing, the emperor died following a long illness in 1913. Lij Yasu and the vacant throne. Following Menelik's death, a power struggle ensued between his grandson, Lij Yasu, and the Showan nobles led by Rastafari Mekonnen, later to be crowned Haile Selassie I. Citing the civil war that had engulfed the country during the previous two emperors, Menelik announced prior to his death that he had chosen his 12-year-old grandson, Lij Yasu, the son of Menelik's daughters, princess Shawaraga, and the Oromo ruler of Wayo, Ras Mikael, to succeed to the Solomonian throne. The need to assure safe succession was underscored by the fact that during Menelik's last days of long illness, the major European powers, Britain, France, and Italy, had signed a tripartite agreement that clearly infringed on the sovereignty of the country. By that agreement, which did not involve Ethiopia, the three colonial powers demarcated their spheres of influence over Ethiopia, Britain claiming to control the headwaters of the Nile, France dominating the territories through which its railway line from Djibouti to Addis Ababa passed, and Italy claiming control over the rest. When the dying monarch's consort, Empress Taitu, tried to dictate state matters from her husband's palace in Addis Ababa, the Showan aristocracy, with the support of Mahal Safari, or imperial bodyguard, rebelled and banished her to Intoto. The young prince, now beyond the control of his guardian, got into daunting political trouble. His attempt to woo Ethiopia's Muslim population and his close relationship with Germany and Turkey, which were enemies of the Allied powers during World War I, led to a plot to overthrow him. The move succeeded with the support of the church, which had excommunicated the young monarch for flirting with the Muslims. Thus, in 1916, Empress Zauditu, the daughter of Menelik, was chosen to take her father's throne, and Rastafari Mekonnen, later Haile Selassie I, was named regent with full political power to rule the country. When his excommunication and overthrow was announced in 1916, Yasu tried to rally his supporters to march on Addis Ababa, but his army faced a resistance led by Haile Selassie I's supporter, Fitaurari Tekla Hawariat, who had modern military training from a famous Czarist Russian military academy. Though Yasu was initially successful in battle, he was ultimately defeated at the Battle of Zagele, a few miles north of Addis Ababa, and was captured after living as a fugitive for a few years. Then he was kept in custody until his death.